How's everyone today? I'm doing great. It is September 9th, 2015. Two more days, right? Well, one more day, really, the 10th and then the 11th. And the 11th, I say it starts a new news cycle. And what I'm suggesting to everyone that I'm taking my own advice to is sit this news cycle out. You know, do we not have a right to sit a news cycle out? Isn't this like, shouldn't this be like a basic human right declaration? We spiritual beings pretending to be humans absolutely have the right to sit a news cycle out, because the news is what it is, and we know what it is, right? So I started in the beginning of September, August 29th. I decided, the Holy Spirit gave me the inspiration saying, you know, just sit this next news cycle out. This is very, very important. I have history with the Holy Spirit told me about, you know, quite some time ago, maybe 15 to 20 years ago, stop watching television for this next year. And you know what I did? I did exactly that. And I look, in hindsight, it was a you know, life-changing situation. It was so important. I wouldn't be here today if not for that. So the Holy Spirit inspired me, saying, sit this next news cycle out. Well, first it said, sit out September. And now it's saying, well, just how about the next news cycle? I say, how long is that? Well, how about through June of 2016? Just sit out the news cycle. Don't, just sit it out. Sit on the sidelines. I said, yeah, I can do that. That's easy. I've done it before. Actually, there have been times, quite a few times, where I've decided to completely, you know, sit out the news cycle and just not pay any attention anymore. It's great. It's actually great. It's kind of like fasting. I mean, we talk about fasting for the body. Well, I would say the best fast in the world is to set out a news cycle. We need to detox from all that stuff. And from looking up through August, I kind of looked at the news a little bit carefully, but I was looking at it. And I'll tell you, it's gone into the garbage disposal. You know, it's in the garbage disposal right now. And the blades, someone's about ready to turn on the garbage disposal. The attitudes are so egoic that I said, I can't take this anymore. I just can't take it. No more. It's too egoic for me. And it repels me. It repels my mind. So it's a great time to sit out, to go on a news fast. And you can tell the people maybe you live with or whoever. I'm just on this, I'm sitting out the news cycle. It's kind of like a news fast. It's something that I feel is very, very, very helpful for me. And I advise it to everybody else. And of course, you know very well when you fast, like if you take a food fast, you try to tell other people to do it. Who listens to you? You know, pretty much nobody, right? Pretty much nobody. However, if you do, sometimes you see someone on a health kick and you can get inspired. And speaking of that, I am on a health kick too. So I might as well share some good habits with you as we start to set out this news cycle, this next news cycle. I would say it's going to start September 11th, 2015, this next news cycle. And it could be an extremely intense news cycle. In fact, so intense that you probably would want to sit it out. In hindsight, you may look back and say, wow, I wish I'd have sat that one out. It would have made all the difference in the world for me. So you don't want to have regrets in hindsight. And so for me, I'm doing the sure thing. You know, if I sit out a news cycle, and it says, well, nothing happened. It was, well, what did I miss then? Really didn't miss anything important. So it's not a loss there. And if it is too overly intense, then I look back and say, wow, it was a great decision. So it's really a win-win. You really can't lose by sitting out a news cycle. You can't lose. Pretty much fasting for the body, you can't lose either. I mean, in August, what was my diet? I was watching the news. What was I eating? Hot dogs, macaroni salad, potato salad, and ice cream. That was basically my diet, along with potato chips and popcorn and Tostitos and dip and, you know, really, you know, this was my, and I just, you know, was blowing up like a balloon. And then I realized it's go time now. So what's my diet now? Well, for breakfast, I have grapefruit juice. That's it. And I keep drinking grapefruit juice throughout pretty much most of the day until dinner. It just, you know, have a, whenever I want a little drink, I have some grapefruit juice. At lunch now, I decide I'm going just to have some Greek yogurt. Yeah, some Greek yogurt, maybe some blueberries and walnuts, and yeah, that's it. And it's good, great protein and calcium and minerals. It's great for you, Greek yogurt. So, grapefruit juice for breakfast, Greek yogurt for lunch. For dinner, I've decided on the spinach salads, pretty much. You know, spinach with some cranberries, walnuts, feta cheese, and some red onions, and maybe I'll put in a, you know, hard-boiled egg for some protein. So, you know, there you go. Oil and balsamic vinegar, and a little bit of maybe some sea salt in there, and good to go. Maybe I'll mix some kale in with the spinach. I'm working on that. I'm going to work that into. So there's my diet. That's my food. Grapefruit juice, Greek yogurt, and spinach, feta cheese, salad. Okay. Pretty simple. So far, I've dropped about, close to 10 pounds already in about, I don't know, about 10 days or so. It's certainly working, and I feel better. I keep feeling better and better. So, you know, it's can't lose on this. Basically, it's a win thing. So try to find some habits that are, you know, just, I can't lose. If I do this, for sure I'm going to look back, in hindsight I'm going to look back and say, well, I'm glad I did that. These are the habits that we want to have, and say, in hindsight, looking back, am I going to say, maybe 10 years from now, I'm talking about that time in my life, I say, you know what, I remember when I did this diet, I remember when I sat on a news cycle, I'm really glad I did that. That was super helpful for me. So sort of project into the future as if you're looking back in hindsight and ask yourself, you know, what can I do now that I'm going to praise myself for later? How about that? What can I do now that I'm going to praise myself for later? And I believe it's very important now for everyone to have at least one good habit that they're working on to get through the times that are to come, which I expect to be, and many of us expect to be, you might say, overly intense. If we have at least one good habit, we say, well, I'm working on this. This is my focus. We have to have some focus here. And I know the spiritual path is a focus, but it's difficult to keep it in focus all the time. We want to stay in the ballpark. We don't want to wander off the reservation. We want to keep ourselves in touch with it, do everything we can to keep in touch. So if you say, yeah, I'm doing this diet, I think this is going to help my concentration, make me feel better, I'm out of the news cycle, so I'll be able to focus in on calm, peace of mind better. And so you're doing something for yourself that, looking back in hindsight, you'll say, you know, I'm really glad I did that. That was a brilliant, brilliant move. And I recognize today, you know, I have an extremely low status in the world. Nobody thinks anything of me in the world. But, you know, so it's hard for me to have any think highly of myself at all. But if I look back, I have to say, you know, I've made some extremely great decisions in my life, which is really why I'm able to be where I am spiritually, which is in a very good place. Is a result of extremely good decisions. Those decisions really were suggested by the Holy Spirit. You know, I like to take credit for them, but not really. The Holy Spirit was guiding and orchestrating me, saying, hey, how about looking at it this way? What do you think if you did this? I'd say, wow, that seems like that would be a really great decision. So when it comes to the spiritual path, I say I'm super successful because great, great decisions. So I feel this advice, you know, is worth giving out. That in hindsight, you want to look back and say, "Wow, I really made some great decisions back then." This is how you succeed. If you make terrible decisions, you're going to go down the garbage disposal. You know, we can't afford to be making really terrible decisions now. You know, we can't afford it. Nobody can afford it. I mean, the stakes are very high right now. So we have no choice but to ask ourselves, okay, in hindsight, how can I please my future self? Really, well, we're going to have a future self, okay? Quote unquote future self. I'm not getting non-dualistic here. I'm just, using common vernacular here. We're going to have a future self. All right? And that future self is going to look back at us and say, hey, with praise or condemnation, saying, wow, I'm in a terrible place now, and you made some horrible decisions back then. I mean, that's just awful. We don't want that. We want to look back and praise and say, wow, thank God I made my past self there made some really, really great decisions, and here, and I'm benefiting from that right now. I'm benefiting from it. Like I say, my previous life, I benefited from the discipline, the determination, the discipline, the attempt to do something great for world culture, to and to be creative in that way, and do all this stuff. Well, I benefited from that this life. Not that I didn't suffer from some other stuff very badly, but the benefit, there was also great benefit. So I can look back and thank the past self and say, thanks for looking out for me a little bit here, And don't you want your future self in the future to look back at you and say, wow, thanks so much for helping me out. Now I wouldn't be where I am today, if I wasn't helped out. Start looking at your life in that way, that you're going to be, you're accountable to your future self right now. We are all accountable to our future self right now. So, for me, it's not goofing off this life. I had a habit of relentless work ethic, and just saying, today I've got to do better than yesterday. And just every day like that. So this is what I did my life, this life. I just kept going. I kept going. I kept the momentum going. Today I've got to do better than yesterday. And I can't fail. I have to keep working at this. And just, relentless work ethic. Which has led to something very, very, very valuable. And what is that? Well, I can tell you what the king of all insights is, the king of all recognitions for us, pragmatically. Because where are we really? We're on a path. Ultimately, we're eternal life right now, but we're on a path to letting go of all distraction from this fact. Okay, so the king of all insights is that, hey, I have to manage the success of my spiritual path. I have to manage my success on the spiritual path. When this dawns upon you, that you become realized about this, you realize it not just intellectual, it dawns upon you, this is real, I really have to do this. It's not just something I get on a test, multiple choice question. What's the most important thing on the path? A, manager's success. Check, I checked it. The teacher says, oh, good, you nice. And then you get your diploma. Okay, it's not like that at all. You realize that, hey, I actually have to do this, and I am doing it, and I'm getting better at it. Then you could say that your success on the spiritual path is assured. It's assured. Because you're doing the one key element, the all-important element, which is to manage your success, which has to do with making sure that you don't wander off the reservation, that you don't backslide too much, that you don't make too many bad decisions, that you keep yourself, engaged. You stay in the ballpark. You stay engaged. Yeah, you might wander off to the snack shop there and eat some food and chat and stuff. You're not paying attention to the game so much all the time, but then you go back to your seat and you pay attention. So you're in the ballpark. It's called stay in the ballpark. Stay in the ballpark. Manage your success. That's the number one key to ultimate success on the spiritual path, which is dropping our distraction and to what we really are. It's dropping our pretending ultimately. Now this all-important realization then will lead to recognizing that the continuity problem is the only problem there is. It will lead to the realization that there's only one problem, that there is. Everybody has exactly the same problem, and it is the continuity problem. There isn't any other problem whatsoever. And mentioning this, I'll bring up the what I said before, is skipping this next news cycle. Because what this next news cycle is really going to do, the way I see it, is it's going to try and convince you that there's all these problems in the world other than the continuity problem. And by doing so, your spiritual progress will be eroded and come to an end, almost, you could say. Because really what we're getting at, our momentum has to get to realizing that, hey, I have a severe continuity problem, and then ultimately you realize that everybody has the exact same problem, really. And that's the only problem there is. There isn't any other problem. So this also dawns upon you. As you manage the success of your path, it will gradually dawn, and there'll come a point when you realize, oh my gosh, I really do have this, but that's great. Because since I realize that it's the only problem there is, and I have it, so I can set it down. I can't set something down I don't have, but because I have it, I can set it down. So it's great. And then the third element, which follows with this, is connected to this, is wow. You know, full stop on the wow. I have to evaporate this continuity problem. I don't get rid of it by intellectualizing it. I get rid of it by wow, experiencing, letting go of it a little bit, and the elation of to say, I did this, and then just resting in this as the shock waves reverberate, and not backtracking, backsliding, not wandering off, getting off track, you know, just sitting with that wow and not avoiding it, full stop on the wow. Like, I'm doing so much better than I thought I would. I'm just really shocked how great I'm doing. This is the spiritual path. You get shocked about how well you're doing because the ego told you you're a complete idiot. Okay, I experienced the ego's full evaluation of me, which is I'm a total idiot, totally incapable of salvation, totally undeserving of it. I'm just the worst so-and-so that there's ever been. I'm totally incompetent. This is what the ego believes. Why? Because it's really just an expression of our continuity fear, and our continuity fear doesn't want us to know who we are at all. So it insists that we're incapable of it, we're incompetent. So as we go along the spiritual path, we find out we're not incompetent. In fact, we're doing great. And this is very, very stunning, because they realize just how wrong the ego is and how controlled we have been by our continuity fear. And it's quite shocking. We say, you mean little old me? I mean, I passed this milestone. Is that possible? I'm not Einstein or somebody. I mean, how could I possibly, you know, this is, wow. You know, just, so if you go right to the wow, it short circuits all of the reactions. So when you decide to commit to the wow, you're short circuiting all other reactions. You refuse to entertain any other reactions. And this then protects your momentum along the path. It protects it. You protect your momentum by temporarily taking a slight break, but refusing to entertain any other reaction, but just wow, which means, hey, I really am doing way better than I thought. No other reaction, just wow. I'm doing better than I ever imagined I could. Wow, wow, wow. And this will happen as you go on the path, because you're so used to believing that you're an idiot, you know, only Jesus can be saved, you know, people, you know, and me, I'm just this sinful, stupid human, I'm incapable of this, you know. And we're so conditioned to believe that we can't really do it, that this is for someone else, you know, and the special ones or something, that it shocks us. So we must avoid backsliding. So just right immediately, wow, I'm doing way better than I ever expected. Wow. So we have these three elements. One, I have to manage the success of my spiritual path. I must always be cognizant of this, that I am going to be very successful, and I have to learn to manage as I go along. Two, I have a severe continuity fear, but it's the only problem that I have, and it's the only problem that there is, right? And three, in evaporating this continuity fear, I'm going to be very successful, and I have to short circuit all other reactions to this, and just full stop in the wow of it, just wow, elation with some trepidation. Don't try to get rid of the trepidation. That's when you get into trouble. Accept it. See, the wow is accepting that I've got a little backlash is gonna happen right now. I know it made a lot of elation, but the backlash is going to be there. So I'm going to honor my creativity by saying, you know, backlash, you're going to be there, I understand. So I'm just going to wait until I kind of get comfortable with this. And then, you see, by honoring your creativity in this way, you don't feel this extra struggle in you. It's okay. You feel okay. I can just sit here and let this calm down. This is true compassion. Compassion is pragmatic love. Love being pragmatic. And this is a supreme pragmatism by honoring ourselves. And then by doing these three steps, you might say you get to the fourth, which is the neither nor, which is the ultimate deal you make with all your thought forms. Everything that your continuity fear has given rise to in terms of our fantasy, dream, wishful thinking, all of this creativity that our continuity fear has given rise to, you decide to make a deal that you're going to honor it. And I neither accept it nor reject it. All these thoughts, all these the long faces, all the people in the realm of long faces, you say, you know, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And that is enough for them. They're easy to please. They say, at least, okay, we've been acknowledged. We've been acknowledged. The king has acknowledged us. He has no longer disowned us. It's like, you know, saying, yes, you are my children. You are my children. I acknowledge it. And that's good enough. That's good enough. And then the continuity fear relaxes and says, you're free to go. You know, you feel free to go back to your home, back to freedom, back to abundance. So these keys, these four keys, you might say, the first realizing that that managing the success of my path is all important, and I have to become a management expert at this. Two, the continuity fear is the only problem there is. There's no other problem. Three, full stop in the wow. Short circuit all the reactions. I'm doing much better than I thought I would do. You know, I got a full stop in this wow. Don't go anywhere else. And then four, the deal with myself, honoring my creativity, which is, you know, neither nor. Neither do I accept these thoughts, nor do I reject them. I neither accept nor do I reject. Both. It's both. You can put it in a positive way. I both accept and don't accept. Or I call it just a neither nor. It's a nice way of looking at it. I neither accept nor do I reject. I neither accept nor reject these thoughts, all this creativity, which is all the arising appearances that have arisen from my continuity fear, which has been dictating everything. It's been a dictator. It's absolutely ruining our, you know, experiencing of our true nature. It is this dictator of continuity fear. But that only arose because we started pretending that we were something different than what we were, in order to try and prove that we could change God, change what God created. It means changing God, so that we could prove we're greater than God. We didn't realize that we'd have this problem, that in pretending we're dead. You know, we think if we stop pretending, we won't have any functionality at all. We've come to identify with this function of pretending. And so you have this hideous continuity fear that I don't dare let go of this pretending. So this is all it in a nutshell. We have it very streamlined, which was my goal. I people were saying, we can't get escape or trapped. You know, I say, what do you mean? They say, well, you know, all this stuff that teaching everything. It's too difficult. We can't do it. And now they don't quite realize that it's their continuity fear that's trapping them. But now we do. Now I know. I said, okay, let me see if I can help out. You know, maybe there's some way to streamline and make it clear and simpler so you can get on the, get, do what you need to do to get free of this, you know, mental troubles you have, the suffering. And so I've been able to do this now. It is very streamlined. Oh, someone's here. Okay. It is very streamlined. It is very clear. It is very simple. And yet, it's not intellectual. That all of this needs to dawn, the recognition needs to dawn in a way, in an integrated way where you feel, this is what I'm doing. This is what I need to do. It cannot be taught like in a classroom, intellectual, like a university or something. It's not something that is just an intellectual, something to grab a hold of intellectually. It must dawn upon you that I really, you know, I really do have a continuity fear. It must dawn upon us. Hey, I really have a severe continuity fear. And this is the only fear that I have, because it's dictating all the dream to me, you know. Or it's causing me to dictate the dream. It's actually not causative. I'm the one that's causative. But the continuity fear is telling me I must do this. I must do this. I must do this. So we have to realize this, that this continuity fear is not just parroting something. We're not the beak of the perico. We're just not the beak of a parrot here. That doesn't work at all. And so, of course, those who are just about intellectually will keep screaming, hey, I'm trapped, I'm trapped, I'm trapped, I'm trapped. Well, they haven't tried. They haven't actually, you know, the continuity fears is still so much in control of them that they're saying, well, I can't really, you know, succeed at the path. No, you know, I just need to, you know, kind of make it look good, sweep it under the rug. And that doesn't work. So, of course, if we do, and it's kind of like looking for something. If we look for it in the wrong place where it isn't, we're not going to find it. So, you know, everyone in the world screaming, I can't find it, I can't find it, I'm not so, well, they're looking in the wrong place. They're looking in the emotions, intellect, you know, the egoic bundle of thoughts, you know, belief system, egoic belief system. And we're not going to find it there. We cannot find it there. Very hot today again. Hit the 103 here. The 103. It's down to maybe about 101 right now, but the sun is hitting me. It's kind of like wow. So we do have the four keys, and we do understand that there are also four sort of steps to, you know, we long. Step one, we're left some sort of longing, like I want something better. Step two, we start praying for something better. Step three, we affirm. We're affirming that we have the right to it. We're not petitioning, we're affirming. You see, we're not saying, God, please take mercy on me. I know I don't deserve it, but if you could find it in the goodness of your grace and mercy to, I know it's undeserved, God, but, you know, I gave a lot of sacrifices to you, and I tried to, you know, I sacrificed the best I had for you, and so I hope that you have mercy upon me, and if you find that my sacrifice is sufficient to please you, and if it is, will you, you know, can you please, like, you know, give me a little bit of happiness, a few scraps of crumbs of happiness. I'd be so grateful. Thank you so much. That's praying, you know. And affirming is like, say, hey, I deserve to be happy. You know, I am happy. Happiness is my nature. I am eternal life. I'm not begging or petitioning anymore. That's the step three. And then in the step four, we actually make a deal to honor our creativity. And we go into abidance. Okay, abidance and peace of mind. Step three enables us to get glimpses of peace of mind. Even step two, okay, you know, might even give us some. Even one. Any of these steps, success can come upon us a little bit, a little glimpse, holy instant. But step four is where we actually go into abidance, step four. And then you might say that step four leads us to the fifth state, which is abidance. Step four is where we are practicing and getting accepting that, you know, abidance is going to happen, and cutting this deal. You know, neither nor. Neither I accept. I neither accept all these thought forms, my creativity, but nor do I reject it. No, I neither accept nor reject. And miracle of miracles, this is sufficient. Our spirit accepts this. It says, you know, it says, I can live with this deal for a while. Okay, ultimately I know I'm going to go beyond even this, but I'm not going to get there unless I make this deal. So I can live with this deal. I absolutely can live with this. And this is so important. I've been preaching this for quite some time. I remember I gave the story, my dad had the cancer, and he came in here, and he was came to the house, and in two or three days it had shrunk down to almost nothing, and he could eat. He couldn't even eat or drink when he came, and he was able to eat and drink just fine. In fact, feast. He was feasting and laughing and enjoying it, and the cancer shrunk down to just a small area. And I told him, I said, listen, the key right now, the right advice I give you is to just live with it. Live with this deal. You made a deal. It worked. You're not going to die of it, okay? And you came to a deal, you made a deal, and he did, he because at that time I was doing very, very intense prayer and affirmation and stuff, and it was very intense atmosphere in the house here. I was totally into it, and it was like 1997 maybe, 1998, around there, and I just gave him a glass of water. I said, drink this. This water had been in a room where all these affirmations were constantly. I had tapes going on 24 hours a day, and holy affirmations taking place by saints, and I just gave him a glass of water and he drank it. 3 days later, the cancer had shrunk down to a small area. But I said, okay, listen. Now the next step is just live with this. Live with this deal. You made a deal. Live with it for a while. This is the key. Well, what happened was he didn't listen to that advice. And he said, wow, I got rid of almost all of it. Now I need to get rid of all of it. And I said, no, it'll come back on you. Don't do that, because you need to get used to, you know, he was trying to, the ego said, hey, really what happened was the ego said, hey, you know, if you get rid of all of it, people will think you're some great teacher or something, you know, but now you got some cancer, they don't think so much of you. Which is true. There's a problem. He had those that looked up to him as some great guru because he was so healthy, and they wanted to be healthy like that. So that having cancer was like completely, you know, they're just like, this can't happen. But then he said, well, I'm going to get rid of it. Don't worry. I'm going to be able to get rid of it and show you that, you know, I'm super healthy. I can even get rid of cancer. And so when it shrank away to almost nothing, but still there's some vestigial amount of it, he said, no, I have to get rid of all of it, otherwise all those who look up to me, they're going to leave me, and even worse than that, actually, they can be very hostile sometimes, right? And so he chose to try to get eradicated, and that was curtains for him. Came back worse than ever. So, unfortunately, it was a very bitter pill for me to swallow, because I knew if he just lived with it and just lived with that deal, he was going to be fine. He'd probably still be with us, which would be a great thing, because he was a really great person. There's no question about it. Very spiritual. Extremely humorous. Great spiritual humorist. Great. Saw things in a wonderfully intuitive way. I mean, he was a super positive force for the world, but he didn't recognize the deeper dynamics of what we're talking about here, the managing your success, the continuity, fear, full stop, and the wow, and the neither nor deal what you make with your own thought forms, the own creativity, thought forms that are expression of your own creativity. And I wasn't able to lay it out for him clearly enough, and I feel very bad about that. I've been working feverishly, you know, since then, and prior to then too. I mean, it's almost 40 years, but since then I've been working feverishly because I say, wow, you know, if I just had known a little more, just then, it could have saved him. From the pressure, you know, he had these devotees after him. You know, devotees can be nasty, let me tell you. You know, if you're not the way they want you to be, you know, there's hell to pay. Really. So you better not just set yourself up that way. You just say, look, it's neither nor. I'm just living with the situation. I'm living with this deal. I made a deal. I'm living with the deal. That's fine for now. That's it. Okay? So if you're, you know, you're the personality, you know, is a cloud. There's a cloud in your sky, or those are the thought forms, and they'll be beautified, and by the Holy Spirit will beautify, and everything will seem. The world will still, you'll still be in the world. It's still here, you know, but it's all the Holy Spirit will transform it somehow when you make this deal, and you're enlightened. But, you know, you still have these thought forms. Great, this is the path I'm on. I'm still on the path. You know, if some people want to look up to you, you know, if they want to look up to you, well, you know, if that's what happens, that's what happens. But I'm just living with the deal, you know, and the last step is taken by God, so that's out of my hands. So I'm not even worried about that. Yeah. So see that, you know, the blocking, the, you know, there's no more ego because I'm accepted. These thought forms accepted the deal, really, and that's the end of the ego. When the thought, your thought forms, I'm calling it our thought forms. When our thought forms accept this deal, that's it for the ego. That's it. It's finished. It's finished. This is the final deal. The neither nor is the final step. In you know, that the deal has been made, and I accept it. I accept it. I'm happy. I insist upon it. I'm happy to have the reminder of my thought forms and all of this. You know, I'm happy because this was like an awesome, awesome adventure that we've been on, trying to be greater than God. It's been an awesome adventure, has it not? And I understand now that, you know, it led nowhere. It's a dead end, and it only was led to fear. Fear is all it is and will ever be. But it was still an awesome adventure. And massive creativity put into it. So of course, I'm going to honor that creativity. I insist upon it, and so does God, the Holy Spirit. Said, yeah, absolutely, you should. God honors our creativity with this. God's not angry with us. God's saying, look at all the creativity you poured into this. That is just, you know, wow. There's my great spirit. You know, there's that spirit that I created so adventurous and with such perfect creativity. You know, wow. Not that God told us to go on this path. He said, make sure you don't try and be greater than me. You're going to have fear. We said, what's fear? I don't know what fear is. What are you talking about? So we make this deal. We make this deal. It's the ultimate deal. You might think of yourself as the ultimate business person. You know, I make this totally awesome deal with myself. Neither nor. Neither nor. Neither nor. I neither accept nor do I reject. I neither accept my past nor do I reject my past. I neither accept self-delusion nor do I reject self-delusion. I neither accept this adventure nor do I reject this adventure. I neither accept my thought forms nor do I reject my thought forms. And be determined about it. Be honest and sincere. And say, this is how I feel. And guess what? Your thought forms are aware of this. And they say, you know what? Let's let him go. We're going to let him go to freedom. He's not going to forget about us. We we are not going to forget about our thought forms. And at least honor our creativity in working all of that. Now maybe this pine cone was all about that, you know? Because ever since I found that huge pine cone, you know, I've come to this realization of making this deal neither nor. And the pine cone, I find, it's like archaic. It represents, let me pull this out. I have it here. Ah, I found a nice little holder for it. I have this. I don't know if we can see it here, but because the light is just striking everything here. But I have this. Yeah, I have this. Let me put it over here. Enormous pine cone, right? It's the pine cone of all pine cones. And I look at it, and it shocked me. It really shocked me. It's archaic. You know, this is what it is. It's really archaic. I feel like it's something that was around 200 million years ago. I feel like I'm holding something like 200 million years old, sort of, you know. But it's not like a rock. It's like a living. It's something that's living that was just produced. And, oh, heavy, heavy, heavy. It's very heavy also. It has a psychologically very heavy component to it. And and I said, you know, I'm going to keep you around. I'm going to keep you around. It's just an unbelievable. I mean, everybody reacted to it in a similar vein, which is they were quite shocked by it and quite amazed. And it caused a reaction in them. No question about it. It still causes a reaction in me. I haven't touched it in a while, but just touching it, oh my gosh, it's so archaic. It sort of, to me, represents all my, you know, all the thought forms that we've had. Just looking back throughout history, you know, in the different epochs that we've been through. Paleocene, was it? I forgot the labels a little bit, but the middle scene, the Miocene or whatever it is, Miocene, and Cenozoic, Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic, I guess, Paleozoic, yeah, Zoic. Let's just say, you know, the last 200 million years or so here on the planet. Maybe, you know, think about all the thought forms that have been at play here and appearing. And this represents that, and it's kind of like, yeah, wow, yuck, wow, you know, it's kind of like, okay, but let's make a deal. It's going to be neither nor. So I came up with this, you know, neither nor. So it remains there. It remains. I don't get rid of it. I don't cut it up. I don't slice it. I don't dice it. I just let it be what it is. Our thought forms have been what they are. Let's not try and struggle with them anymore. Whatever appearances have appeared, that's what's appeared. Let's just honor the effort and creativity that went into having all this dance take place. So this is the neither nor. Do I neither accept this pine cone, nor do I reject it. I neither accept it, nor do I reject it. I neither accept it, nor do I reject it. And having this pine cone here is good practice, because it's very intimidating, I have to say. Very intimidating. I don't know why, but it is. It's like something from another planet or another age, you know. It just doesn't seem to be of this world at all. So I neither accept you, but nor do I reject you. I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. And I find a calm and peace coming into my mind by doing this. I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. So you might have something that come into your life to help you practice this way, that puts you under pressure and where it helps you out. I feel this is like a meditation aid, this pine cone, actually. I keep it a little distance from me, you know, because I'm not accepting it, but nor do am I rejecting it. So I neither accept you, nor do I reject you, pine cone. It's over there about 3 feet away from me, just sitting there, you know, like, oh, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. I neither accept you nor do I reject you. You see? And just speak to it like that. Speak to it. Speak to something. Maybe you'll find something that you, brings about this feeling and you're like, wow, this is just too much. And just put it at a distance from you and just say, hey, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And you'll find a different state of mind from doing this. And you'll say, hey, this I wonder if this is a spiritual state of mind I'm getting close to. I'm started dawning upon me. Well, it is. It is. It's the deal. It's the deal that we make where we're freed from being a hostage to our own, to our continuity fear, actually, as it expresses through this dream. A dream of many long faces, the people of long faces, very, you know, misery and suffering. They've been suffering for so long. They think they'll suffer forever. This is their mindset, it's the mindset of the world. This world believes it's going to suffer forever, really, in spite of its bravado. You know, occasionally it throws up some bravado. Speaking of, apropos of nothing, but shifting gears to something interesting, is I had some conversations today with various people, and one of them was, I know what it was. Yeah, there you go. A chance encounter. You know, I was nice, you know, and little talk, and, you know, something came up, and this had to do with some very wealthy people in the area, and there's a lot of them, and they hire personal assistants. And this personal assistant works with taking care of the wife and the family, the kids and the wife. You know, isn't it nice? The wife has their own personal assistant. And, well, these people are super wealthy, have anything they want, but their kids have problems. One kid's autistic. The other kid has some extraordinary obsessive OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, where they can hardly sleep, they can hardly eat, they just read all the time, and then they can't stop moving. They stop and they have to keep exercising and moving, and they just can't, you know, and it's hell. And the doctors don't know what it is, what to do about it. They just, you know, and so they got these terrible problems with their kids. Think about that. You have all the wealth in the world, but you got a kid that won't eat or sleep and is just completely tweaked. That's a rough road to hoe, isn't it? You know, we think that rich people are all happy and stuff. No. There's some thorn in the flesh they have that's like, it's agony, because they say, man, all the money in the world and I can't. Well, I mean, look at Steve Jobs, all the money in the world and he died of cancer, you see. Right? All the power, all the influence, all the adulation, all the cult status and rock star status, all that stuff. You know, money couldn't deal with that, right? Because he didn't know about these four steps here on the spiritual path. I wasn't employing them. I didn't make the deal, you know? Not to say that that's ultimately going to, you know, cure you of everything necessarily, but I feel, we'll see what happens. I feel making this deal, I mean, we'll see what happens. If we get sickness, we say, look, I'll just honor the thought form of the sickness and let the Holy Spirit transform it into honoring my creativity. And wonderful, you know. We have to look at sickness that way, too. When we talk about all our thought forms, we're talking about sickness. Sickness is nothing but thought forms. That's all that it is. Those are just thought forms. Whatever the sickness is, it's just a thought form. All of this is just thought forms. This whole world, you might even say the whole universe, just thought forms. So, sure, we honor our thought form of cancer just as much as any other thought form. And, in fact, a lot of creativity went into that. Massive, right? Massive creativity and dedication to bring about these thought forms of what we call sickness and illness. So we can pretend that we're not spirit. I put huge effort into the sickness. So honor all those thoughts. And so if a cancer happens to come, we say, I neither accept you, cancer, nor do I reject you. I absolutely neither accept you, nor do I reject you. And I'm absolutely sincere about this, you know. And this has to do with all thought forms, all the long faces, you know. And I was able to convince the whole kingdom of the long faces that I would be true to my word. I would neither accept you nor reject you, and I would honor you in this way. And they allowed me to go free. And so that has to do with all the long faces of sickness, all different types of infirmities and sickness and unhappiness and misery and ersatz happiness and, you know, all the emotions that we think are what we really want, but they're not really, you know. It's not true peace of mind. All that stuff. That's actually just different forms of long faces. They all have long faces. Yeah, I'm happy, but, you know, my kids are, you know, this way. Or, yeah, I'm happy, but I don't really know how to keep it. I might lose it. You know, it's still a long face. It's all long faces in this kingdom. So I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. And just leave it at that. Just live with that. Leave it at that. And get used to it. Ultimately, God will take the final step where we realize that you know, we're moving on from pretending altogether. And the Holy Spirit will remain to bless all our creativity. And that in itself is a reminder of our, you know, this misadventure, which was quite a wild ride, is the Holy Spirit remains to bless everything. The Holy Spirit, God created the Holy Spirit because of our attempt to pretend to be something that we're not. So the fact the Holy Spirit remains with us, and it will forever, it is a permanent honoring of our creativity, or our attempt to be greater than God. It's instead of God being threatened by this, God gave us some way to permanently honor this, because this was an expression of just how free we really are. Okay? So the Holy Spirit remains with us forever. But once we have fully acclimatized to reality, our home, then the Holy Spirit no longer needs to try and orchestrate our freedom. You know, it's succeeded, but it remains with us as a blessing function. Now, for those who are still needing the orchestration, it continues to do that until all are free, and then it remains as a blessing to all our creativity forever. So we can't lose this way. You see, we can't lose. So we can make this deal, neither accept you nor reject you. I neither accept this nor do I reject this. I neither accept you nor do I reject you. I'm willing to see you in the form of neither nor. I neither accept you as a tree nor do I reject you as a tree. I neither accept you concrete as I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Concrete, I neither accept you nor reject you. Concrete, I experience you in the form of I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Plant, I experience you now in the form of the thought form of I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And so we can say this to everything we see. Sky, I now experience you in the form of thought form of I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Universe, I'm now experiencing you in the thought form as I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And I just had a little constellation of flashbacks to when I was quite young, how I felt then, and in the awareness of this. See, children are often aware, spiritually aware, they just don't know how to express it. How can you express it, especially in this world? So they have this feeling of awareness, but gradually it gets submerged here in land of the realm of the long faces and the ignorance, which is really, this is just an expression of severe continuity fear. Suffering, I neither accept you nor reject you. Illness, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Anxiety, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Despair, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Misery, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Suffering, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Fatigue, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. A nice little breeze here. Any breeze is appreciated on a day like this. Precious little breeze. But if there was a little more breeze, it would be great. But breeze, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Heat, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Illness, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. So we're not passing judgment on any of our thought forms, are we? We're saying, I neither accept them, nor do I reject them. Existence, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Life, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. Experiencing, I neither accept you, nor reject you. seems to be there's a sort of relaxing of my mind taking place. I sort of feel sleepy during this. Of course, the sun is the hot late afternoon sun is hitting me too. But I feel very drowsy. But my thoughts seem to have, you know, very much calmed down. Now, we say that's okay. Now, what if we all our thoughts seem perfectly calm? We go into peace of mind. We say, "Where's my thoughts? Where's my thoughts?" No, I have them. My thoughts in neither nor mode right now. All my thoughts are been put into neither nor. I'm neither thinking this nor not thinking it. I'm neither thinking this nor not thinking this thought. I'm neither thinking this thought about blah 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 about baseball nor not thinking this thought about baseball. Which I do think thoughts about baseball, you know. How's the starting pitcher going to do tonight? You know, we really need a good start from the starting pitcher. Yeah. Trivial stuff, but I try to keep my thoughts pretty trivial in ways thinking about stuff, you know, thinking about the world. Not reason, of course. Reason is different than thinking. This comes from the Holy Spirit, actually. You know, this thought about baseball, I neither accept this thought about baseball nor do I reject it. I neither accept this thought about school nor do I reject it. I neither accept this thought about work nor do I reject it. I neither accept this thought about so and so nor do I reject it. I neither accept it nor do I reject it. And the intellect will say, well, there's dissonance, it can cause dissonance, but the spirit, what actually happens is you start feeling peace of mind, you start relaxing, you know? This is how the hostage gets set free. The negotiations suddenly turn in your favor. You say, well, I don't quite understand, but they seem to like this deal. You know, my thought forms is, wow, I never thought they could possibly accept this. Yeah, what? I thought I had to destroy my thought forms. I neither accept this thought about school, nor do I reject it. I neither accept this thought about my parents, nor do I reject it. I neither accept this thought, nor do I reject it. I neither accept all my thoughts, nor do I reject all my thoughts. I neither accept any of my thoughts, but nor do I reject any of my thoughts. I neither accept any of my thoughts, nor do I reject any of my thoughts. I neither accept this rock, nor do I reject this rock. I neither accept this wall, nor do I reject this wall. I neither accept this world. I neither accept this world, nor do I reject this world. I neither accept this world, nor do I reject this world. And live with that. And the ego will say, well, you want a purist, or you've got to be, I need a great guru who's a purist. You say, well, that's the ego, that's our continuity fear. We'll see what kind of peace of mind comes from this, and you know, we'll find out. Because what were our thoughts? It was our creativity. How can we reject our own creativity? It's not possible. We have to honor it. Is imagination creativity? Of course it is. It's not the way of creativity that we really, really want, but it's still creativity. Absolutely it is. Everything we do is our creativity. Pretending to be dead is our creativity. You're pretending to be something you're not. Isn't that being creative? Yes, sir. I'm pretending to be some movie star or something, you know. And, well, that's being creative. You know. I'm not that, but I'm being creative. So we're pretending to be, you know, dead. You know, that's very creative. It takes taken massive creativity. Now, of course, using our creativity to pretend we're not free is not the kind of use of our creativity that we enjoy, but certainly we honor the fact that of our creativity. We still love it. We can't help but love our creativity. It's not like, you know, this is how we're created. We love our creativity. We can't hate our creativity. It's not possible. It's not possible. So how do we, you know, gently set down this misuse of creativity? You might say it's a misuse, if you want to use that term. And so you can use any term you want as long as you make this deal of honoring it. You know, then you see all this intellectual squabble, all these quibbles, called the whole quibble of, well, you can't this term or that term. None of that matters anymore, because you can say whatever you want as long as you make this deal. You know, neither nor. Make the neither nor deal, then all the labels, all that stuff, mere quibbles, it makes no difference whatsoever. You're just saying, well, I neither accept this world nor reject this world. I neither accept the Paleozoic era, nor do I reject it. I neither accept the Mesozoic era, nor do I accept it. I neither accept the Cenozoic era, nor do I reject it. I neither accept the Phanerozoic epoch, nor do I reject it. And that's the epoch of the three eras of Paleo, Meso, and Cenozoic, where all these thought forms were jumping all over the planet, you know. Right? It's like, you know, these human thought forms have been around not a couple million years or whatever, but before that, there's a lot of thought forms jumping around the planet. And that pine cone was falling on some soil, you know, 200 million years ago. Pine cone just like this was dropping, boom, on some soil with pine needles underneath it, right? Some dinosaur was coming along and cracking it open and eating the pine nuts inside it. Yeah, you might even call it dinosaur food, actually. Yeah. So I neither accept the Phanerozoic epoch, and nor do I reject the Phanerozoic epoch. I neither accept it, nor do I reject it. And the eras within those, and the periods within those, and the, you know, the various subdivisions, I neither accept it, nor reject it. I neither accept this soil, nor do I reject this soil. I neither accept those rocks, nor do I reject those rocks. You know, you look at the... sedimentary rock, the metamorphic, or the igneous rock. Say, I neither accept you, nor do I reject you, rock. Whatever kind of rock you may be, if it's granite, I think that's igneous. And I think it's intrusive cooling. It cools within the earth. That's why we have these mountain ranges that are made of granite. It's in magma. It's in intrusive cooling, as opposed to extruded cooling. So it cools down slowly, and you get this sort of this crystalline, you know, structure like granite. So I neither accept you, nor do I reject you, granted. I neither accept you, nor do I reject you. And then you get the extruded magma, which is like lava type of basalt. You know, we have the great basalt traps, Siberian salt traps, the Deccan basalt traps, massive areas of basalt lava flowing out and cooling a certain, and it's very fine-grained, you know, it's not like crystalline in structure. And you know, so you say, hey, you know, basalt traps, I neither accept you nor reject you. Mountains made of the mountains are rock. I mean, you take off the skin, you know, they're rock. And we live on a rock. We live on this with all this rock, actually. So rock, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And then we have the sedimentary, which is laid down by sediment of all different types. You know, we have the chalky sediment. It's actual era. Chalk era was a Triassic, Jurassic, and Cretaceous. Cretaceous means chalk. So chalky time. I neither accept you, chalk, nor do I reject you. I think chalk was like some kind of microorganisms or something, right? It's just like unbelievable amount of microorganisms in shallow water and all these shallow seas. It used to be the lands of the world were covered with, you know, so many shallow seas, warm shallow seas, and microorganisms thrived there for, you know, millions and millions, you know, tens, hundreds of millions of years, maybe just laying down chalk, laying down, just dying, you know, every, I don't know how long they lived, maybe a day or two or less, and then they just, you know, sink to the bottom, whatever. And this accretion is like constantly going on, just this little accretion, but it's constantly taking place. And over the many millions of years, you get build up, you know, sedimentary rock. And then, of course, metamorphic rock is just the heat and the pressure applied to this planet of, you know, all the different subluxations of the land masses and various changes we've had. And it's subjected, gets buried, gets subjected to heat. You know, the lower the rock, the more buried, the more pressure's on it, more heat. It actually changes form in different types of rock, metamorphic, something that's been, used to be one form, but now it's been changed into some other form. So we have these three types of rock on this planet, and underneath that all this molten, a lot of molten magma. So hey magma, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Hey volcano, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Got that? And you can use that for everything you come in contact with, which are just merely thought forms. We're just coming in contact with our own thought forms here. The pine tree has been around for, you know, conifers were like the tree of the past. I mean, that's like basically the first, I don't know if they're the first trees, but they're, you might say they're the most, maybe the most ancient, you know, trees around is conifers. Conifers developed very early on. Very early on. So, hey, you know, conifer, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And you're talking about, I don't know, maybe how long have conifers been around? Were they in the Paleozoic era? Probably. You know, vegetation, you know, so maybe, you know, it's could be, you know, 300, 400 million years old, 500 million years old. These conifers have been around for a long time. So, hey, conifer, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Hey, redwood tree, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And we got some big redwood trees around here, believe me. Gigantic. But I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Now, you might be saying, hey, you know, this is like quite different than the other narratives of the world of other paths, right? Like environmental, you know, nature loving, because they're saying, oh, I love you, 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 oh, you're so wonderful tree, oh, I love you, you know. Yeah, it is quite different, isn't it? It is quite different. This path here, we're aiming for, you know, peace of mind, where no longer are we reacting at all to any of our thought forms. And ultimately, we go beyond thought forms to perfect freedom. And we no longer look at it, anything at all, as a, constituting any type of thought form at all, ultimately. But we're not worried about that. We're just focused on abiding in this deal that we've made. We've made a deal, and we're living with it, okay? This is the best way to look at it. We made a deal, and we're living with it. And we're happy to live with it. Now, if somebody wants to say, well, if you go further, I'd worship you, I'd be your devotee, I say, well, you're out of luck. You know, you're out of luck, because I made a deal, and I'm honoring that deal. I'm living with it. Because you're not going to be released as a hostage. You're not going to be released until you're sincere. You know, you're really sincere about honoring your creativity. You will not be released. So as long as you're trying to skip that step to try to be some great teacher so you'd be idolized or something, you're not going to get free. You're not going to get free. And then you become bitter, you know. And what do? You just study more books and try to be smarter or something. But that's a dead end. That's a dead end. Many have been there and done that already. Yeah, so it's a dead end. You have to make this deal. Our creativity is not the devil, you know. It may have appeared as the devil, you know, but that was just an expression of our continuity fear, actually. It's all that it ever was. There isn't any real self-existent devil or anything like that. It's just a play of our imagination trying to deceive us into not realizing we've just been pretending all of this. That's all that it's just a play of our continuity fear. That's all that it's been. It doesn't matter what form it takes at all, what the names, the labels don't matter at all. It's just I both accept you and do not accept. I neither accept you. The form, what we're doing here. We just use the neither nor. I neither accept you nor do I reject you. Tree, I neither accept you nor do I reject you. I'm neither accepting of you nor am I rejecting of you. Now, you know, we never thought about this thought form, like applying it like this and saying, look, all thought forms, I'm going to transform you all into this neither nor format and see you that way. In miracle of miracles, the thought forms, we say, yeah, I agree to that. I agree to that. That's acceptable to me. Which is really our own continuity fear saying, it's acceptable to me. Because, you know, continuity fear is just our own fear of stopping the pretending, and we don't really want to have that continuity fear, but we realize that, you know, it's there because we're afraid we won't have any function. So we make a deal, and it satisfies it and says, okay, I'm going to relax now. I'm going to relax. The fear is going to relax. And it's a deal, and we live with it. And those who are too frightened and don't know about this, ignorant about it, they think they have to destroy all thought forms, get free, and, you know, get in and that kind of stuff, attack, get rid of them, kill the ego, all this kind of stuff. And so they think that, they say, I'm on a path, I'm going to be a greater, I'm going to be the greatest guru, the greatest teacher, I'm going to get rid of all thought forms, you know. And they just, you know, it's full of bravado, but it's ignorant, it's ignorance. So they think that, I'm on a greater path than you, you know. And so I don't really need to pay attention to you. I can admonish you, so you're not doing the right thing. But it doesn't work that way. No, this is not it. They stall out. They can't go any further. They're trying to defeat something. We're not trying to defeat anything here. We're not trying to attack anything. We're not trying to get rid of anything, defeat anything. It's just we want to stop pretending is all, which is our absolute right. We're not attacking our pretending. We just want to ease off of it and ultimately no longer pretend at all that we're something we're not. And so we need to evaporate the continuity fear and make a deal with our thought forms and our creativity that we're going to have this neither nor form of our, you know, format and live with that for a while. And that's enough, okay? So as you hear this, you know, it sinks in bit by bit. And the wow arises, saying, you mean there actually is a way for me? Wow. You mean I'm actually hearing this? Wow. Now, it's quite likely if you're hearing this, it means you're very advanced. Because this is very advanced information. It's the end of our ignorance, really. It's the end of our ignorance. So it's very, of course, it's advanced. But it's very streamlined. So, you know, if you're hearing this, it probably is sinking in. It's in some way. Well, it's so hot out here. I brought some cool water from inside. And it's already warm. No more coolness to the water. So even though we may be quite advanced, this still is a big wow, because we say it. I can see it in a format that I can remember it. What is that thing down there? I've never seen this before in my life. What is this? Interesting. It's a bungee cord that's broken in three places. How can a bungee cord break in three places? That's bizarre. Oh, I see what. Interesting. You know, you would think of a bungee cord snap, wouldn't it snap in one place? But this is like, it's snapped in two places. Wow. That's pretty symbolic, wouldn't you say? It seems that what I've been get is that there's going to be two breaking points in the world, two snapping points, two double impact coming up. You know, as I said, what did I start out the video with? Hey, avoid the news cycle. Sit out the next news cycle. And I take it seriously. Sit out the next news cycle. But just decide, you know what, I'm going to do something really good for myself. I'm going to treat myself for being such a great, adamant student of truth. I'm going to treat myself to a freedom from new cycle chocolate ice cream sundae. Yeah, so we're going to align with this. Align, 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 align with the truth. Align with the truth. Do something that in hindsight will be so appreciative. You know, in hindsight we'll say, wow. A lot of us think that once you die, that's it. And say, what doesn't matter? You know, I don't need to honor my future self at all. I can do whatever the heck I want. And it's not true. It's not true at all. You'll have another life, and then you'll if you didn't make wise decisions, you'll regret it and say, wow, but my previous life, how stupid I was. Why am I suffering so bad? I can't believe. What are these troubles from? You know, well, they're from bad decisions that you made previously, such as, you know, remaining glued to the news cycle. I can't think of any worse thing to do, and yet some do it, you know. So they're not listening to the Holy Spirit, I can tell you that. It's the ego saying, no, this will give me an advantage, real advantage. You'll be smarter than other people. Really? All we have to be smart about is realizing the only problem that we have is the continuity problem. We have to be smart about managing our path as a success. We have a only problem, there's the continuity problem. Full stop in the wow, and then making this deal. That's the neither nor deal. That's all we have to be smart about. So how is watching the news making us smart about that? If anybody can say, well, oh, sure, that's the overwhelming purpose of the news, is to that's what all it does is focus exactly on those four steps. Well, I've never seen any, even the tiniest indication that that's true. And I think anyone who would say that is simply engaging in extraordinary, you know, fantasy, wishful thinking. They're engaged in just wishful thinking, contrary to the facts. Now, the idea has come up here, been floated here on this channel of, you know, I've made some graphics, some videos with graphics on them, and, you know, not too many views, but the idea is you could always just listen to the audio of this tape and watch the graphics as you're listening to it. And I may amend the graphics and put some, you know, reminders like now and a line and full stop in the wow, and just a few little reminders on the graphics to just keep reminding you, to keep you engaged, help you engage. This is a great idea, actually. It's a great idea. You can just mute the audio. If I put any audio in the graphics, which I have, you can mute the audio, listen to the audio on this video, and watch the graphics instead. And it's sort of, it may help you. Maybe some don't like this. And I know that there's difference. Some people said, you know, have said they absolutely love the graphics, and then others, no response at all, and not, you know, very few views of them. So it, for some people, it might be very helpful. So, this is just an idea. I don't have to do this at all. But the graphics are just designed to help us stay in the ballpark, stay engaged. If we're burned out on this, we go, wow, I just need to cool out a little bit. Well, you know, you can wander into all sorts of distractions from this standpoint. You say, I want to be distracted for a while. Be very careful what you pick as a distraction. Be conscious of it. Be conscious of the fact that, hey, I'm going to distract myself a little while. I just feel I need to cool off of this. Be very careful what you pick, and be conscious that you're distracting yourself a little bit, and use something that helps loop you right back into awareness, you know, that loops you back into it. But I'm also getting a no in my psyche too, you know. It's interesting. So some say no, some say yes. I just have to meditate on that. It's interesting. Some little, I'm aware of some sort of resistance, something, an issue there. So I'll just see how that plays out. I think, there's a bumblebee, and the cat is trying to go after the bumblebee here. Okay. Then decides, no, I don't really want to go after the bumblebee. I think I have to be careful not to get too much into graphics, because it could send out the wrong message, you know. But if it's, you know, if it's in the right context, if it's taken in the right context, it's a different story. So the cat decided, I'm not really interested in the bumblebee, but it interested me a little bit. Now it sat down quietly here. So maybe by the cat chasing a bumblebee, it stops chasing after a lizard, you know. It satisfies its desire to be distracted with a bumblebee. Okay, I see. Yeah. Hi, cat. The cat now is just sitting very quietly and calm, not really thinking about chasing after lizards, which it likes to do, because its attention is on the bumblebee. But it says, that bumblebee doesn't really look like what I really want to go after, but it's intriguing enough that I keep my attention on it. But meanwhile, I'm sitting calm and quiet, you see. I'm not getting agitated. It's very important that whatever you're using as a diversion, distraction, doesn't get you agitated. And leads to more agitation, it leads to more agitation, it leads to more agitation. So this cat, if that was a lizard, this cat would be all frantic, and his attention would be fixated on the lizard. Be all, you know, and now it's kind of like, you know, I'm kind of interested in chasing that, attacking that bumblebee, but I'm also not interested. I'm neither interested nor not interested. Yeah, I'm neither interested nor not interested. And my awareness is kind of open to everything that's going on, instead of being really closed down and fixated. When the cat's going after a lizard, it's totally fixated on it, man. Nothing else exists. So, there could be. Or the resistance could be coming from hi, cat. The cat actually sees me now. It's not so distracted. Hello. It actually looked at me. See, it's good for it. Usually doesn't do that. Certainly if it was looking at a lizard, it would not do that at all. See, now it's very calm. Now it's going on its way, but it's calmed down. Interesting. I think the ego wants us. The ego doesn't mind if we listen to some spiritual topic, presentation, as long as it can then backslide us away from it and distract us completely away from it. Because then it feels it's delaying. It's doing its delaying job. Whereas if you keep yourself in the ballpark, it's a lot more effective. It's a lot more effective. So people might watch a video and then go out and do something that's completely different, and before you know it, they've completely forgotten what it was about, you know, or just completely lost some sort of continuity, you know. I don't know. Or maybe it's better to watch, you know, watch me here with the gestures and the feeling. Maybe people, you know, prefer that too. That's quite, you know, quite possible. Maybe that's preferable. Yeah. I don't know. That's interesting. Certainly graphics are a slippery slope. There's no question about it. Have to be very judicious in how you use them. Easy to go astray. Depends on, you know, each one of us. Okay, so how are we doing here? Yeah, we did a good run here. Not going to get so hot, and don't want to overload you right now. And also, I don't want to get so involved in graphics that I spend too much time at it, because, you know, I've got to stay focused on this. It's an interesting question. Because graphic work, you can really do a lot with that. It's pretty much endless, really. Once you get into it, you just realize that, you know, you can be so creative in endless ways here with graphics. So, all right, cool down. We're just here at the end of it. Take a break from the news cycle. Sit this next news cycle out. Have a good habit that you're focusing on. A very important habit you're focusing on, and you want to succeed at this. Don't let anything interfere with it. Remember the four key steps that we have here, which is realizing that managing our success on the spiritual path is all important. We only have one problem, and there's only one problem. That's the continuity fear. That's it. There is no other problem. Continuity fear problem. And full stop in the wow is how we evaporate the continuity fear and short circuit all other reactions, so we don't backslide. And then fourth, we make a deal of honoring our creativity, all our thought forms, all our creativity that have arisen from our continuity fear, by the neither nor deal. You know, I neither accept you, pine cone, nor do I reject you. I neither accept you nor reject you, or we could say I both accept you and don't accept you. I both accept you and do not accept you. You can use that positive form way too. I both accept you and don't accept you. Or you can use the neither do I neither accept you, nor do I not accept you. And that may be even more powerful, the neither nor. Because you're starting out right off the bat showing, hey, look, this is the truth. I'm not accepting. I neither accept you. Let me get that right up front. So you're right up front about it. I neither accept you, but nor do I not accept you. That might be the best way to do it. I'm leaning that way right now. Neither nor. A neither nor format. Okay. Very great. We have now just one day, the 10th before 9/11/2015, the double jubilee. Mark, you know, the double jubilee of 9/11, the double jubilee. And don't think that those who are totally in this, the symbolic impact that symbology has upon the psyche of our egoic belief system, don't understand the potent symbology of that. They very much work through potent symbology and archetypal stuff and used to, you know, to amplify our reactions and all this kind of stuff. So I'm sure they're very aware of those, that situation, and the impact it could have upon everyone. So we're going to set this new cycle out. Thank you very much.